Hi everyone, this is my vlog for the curriculum and assessment module for teaching and learning. This vlog is going to be split up into four sections. First, I'm going to be looking at evaluating the economic, social and political factors that influence curriculum and assessment design. Then I'll be identifying and reviewing current and relevant policies and its impact on curriculum and assessment design and delivery. From then, I will be discussing the annotations that I've made on the Pearson's BTEC Level 3 National Certificate in Performing Arts Specification. And then finally, I'll be reviewing and evaluating my assessment tool that I have implemented inside my sessions, looking into the students' feedback, considering the overall effectiveness from the point of view of its fairness, validity, reliability, sufficiency, and also I'll be considering some areas of improvement for if I were to use this tool again. First, I'm just going to give a little overview on what curriculum is and also what assessment design is. So a curriculum is a collection of lessons and assessments that will be taught in an educational setting or institution. It's important inside the educational setting as it inputs some order into what is taught and also communicates clear expectations for both the teachers and the students. Assessment design is looking at the context that is inside the curriculum and ensuring that formal and informal assessments reveal students' progress towards the end goal. Both of these can be impacted massively by different economic, social, and political factors. Economic factors such as funding and economic student setting can impact curriculum and assessment design massively. This can cause disadvantages in things such as schools' attainment and quality of technology, professional pay scales, and taxes. Technology began as an advantage in the educational setting. However, in today's society, it's grown into a necessity. This has put massive pressure on the public education as the need for technology has accelerated, which has caused the cost to escalate. Some schools which are located in less privileged areas may struggle with this as good quality technology costs a lot of money. Some curriculum is heavily influenced by technology. If the school does not have the money for this equipment, this puts a massive disadvantage on the students attending these educational settings. The pandemic has also brought worldwide attention to the economic impact on learning as all teaching went online. This showed us that many children were unable to attend education for several months as they were unable to attain the correct technology. This would have caused a massive impact on curriculum and assessment design as the students were unable to learn the information in the curriculum, meaning the assessments would show little progress in the students' development. Professional pay scales will also have a huge impact on curriculum and assessment design. Some people argue that teachers are underpaid compared to other professions. This is causing teachers to see opportunities outside of the educational settings that is better pay. Also, teachers are required to undergo massive amounts of training to attain jobs in these settings, which other non-educational settings they will not have to do this. This is putting pressure on curriculum and assessment design as there is limited teachers who are able to teach and willing to teach at this higher standard, which will have an impact on the assessment design. All of these factors are based off the inequalities in funding and tax variations in each area. The less money the schools get, the less they are able to offer their students, which will inevitably affect the curriculum and assessment design inside the educational area. Our multicultural society is a key factor that is taken into consideration for curriculum and assessment design. Some factors of diversity include religion, culture, race, gender, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, age, and also children with different kinds of disabilities and additional needs. When talking about culture and religion, this can both have a positive and negative effect on curriculum and assessment design. If we think about and consider the number of groupings in different societies that individuals live in, there are many different factors to include inside these. This could be seen as challenging for curriculum and assessment design as there are many different views that need to be considered. This could also inhibit religious groups' learning as they could miss out on things in the curriculum because they believe this will undermine their belief systems due to their cultures. However, the design of the curriculum materials and their presentation should accommodate the culture of the society, and it should be sensitive to the fact that curriculum design is inclusive for everyone. Socioeconomics is another factor that could cause a huge impact on students' curriculum and assessment design. Wealthier families have the financial support to send their children to high-quality schools, hire tutors, and obtain extra resources, whereas low-income families may not be able to attend schools, and those who do may have the added pressure to leave education early to work. As I said earlier, there are loads of social factors that can affect curriculum and assessment design. However, it is the schools and awarding bodies' role to ensure that the curriculum and assessment design is as inclusive as possible to ensure that no student is at a disadvantage because of this. Political factors such as political views could have a huge impact on how curriculum is delivered and how assessment is designed. Teachers who have strong political views shouldn't let this influence curriculum, but inevitably they do. It could influence what one teaches, who the teachers are, and how the teachers and schools are organised. Politics determine and define goals, contexts, learning experiences, and evaluation strategies in education, meaning that curriculum materials and teachers' interpretations are heavily influenced by political considerations. Also, things like fundings of educational settings and entry levels of educations are influenced by this too. This could cause a negative impact as it could affect the way in which teachers deliver and teach their curriculum and also their views on what they're going to include inside the assessments. Though some people would hate to admit it, political power over content, goal, learning experiences and evaluation strategies is enormous. Curriculum materials are often used as tools to shape a certain image and philosophy in students' minds. It's done so the students will later be able to find their place in society and bring a profit to the community. As discussed, all of these economic, social, and political factors can cause huge impact on curriculum and assessment design. However, there is lots of different systems put in place to ensure that these do not inhibit the learning or learning environment of the students. British values play a huge part in maintaining equality throughout. It looks into democracy, the rule of law, individual liberty, mutual respect and tolerance of those of different faiths and beliefs. And there are also many different funding organisations to make sure that students are able to get an equal chance. For this next section, I will be identifying and reviewing current and relevant policies and its impact on curriculum and assessment design and delivery. There are many different policies that have been put in place that could impact this. The three policies I'm going to be discussing today will be the Sainsbury Review from 2016, Prevent from 2011, and finally looking at supporting Ukrainian children to integrate into English schools. First, I'm going to be talking about the Sainsbury's Review. In November 2016, the government appointed an independent panel on technical education. Technical education is the academic and vocational preparation of students for jobs. Technical education plays a vital role in human resource development by creating skilled manpower, enhancing industrial productivity, and improving quality of life. The Sainsbury Review was created to simplify the system. Before this review, there was over 20,000 courses from 160 providers, and they found this too confusing. The independent panel simplified this so the technical education provided through 15 high quality routes rather than 160. This will help the curriculum design and delivery as it will be more clear on what you need to focus on throughout the term and what specific subject you will be teaching. This will also make the quality of teaching a higher level as they'll be able to pinpoint what they need to work on throughout the curriculum. Also, as these qualifications are getting students ready for jobs, tech levels are likely to include multiple forms of assessment, these being both synoptic assessments and assessing behaviour. Synoptic assessments looks at the understanding of links between different elements of the subject, so looking at theoretical and practical. This is great for students as it allows a holistic approach to curriculum and encourages deep learning. However, this assessment method is currently under research topic in the field of education assessments, which could cause issues later on. This offers students more practical approach to assessment rather than more academic, which it has been in the past. This allows students who possibly struggle with academia to excel and show their development through different types of assessment. The behavioural assessments are held in the work placements. This is beneficial as it allows the students to understand what level of professionalism is expected in the working world. However, these assessment methods means that the work placement employer has to ensure they are consistently judging and assessing, which could create a burden on the employer and then could later deter them from offering high quality placements. This could cause an impact in the assessment as it could be rushed and unfair as they are not getting offered high quality training. Also, as students choose one tech level each, this allows students to understand what they need to achieve throughout the curriculum design and what type of assessments deliveries they will need to use to allow optimum learning and development. Now I'm going to be discussing the PREVENT strategy. The PREVENT strategy, published by the government in 2011, is part of the overall counter-terrorism strategy. The aim of the PREVENT strategy is to reduce the threat to the UK from terrorism by stopping people becoming terrorists or supporting terrorism. However, preventing terrorism will mean challenging extremist ideas that are also part of terrorist ideology. ETF standards state that teachers should understand their professional role and responsibility and challenge your practice, values and beliefs. In this case, it may not be comfortable to challenge this, but it's your role as a teacher to make sure that students understand what is the correct type of behaviour to try and eliminate radicalisation. This could impact curriculum design and delivery, as you would have to consider promoting this throughout all your sessions. This would look like adding things like British values into your curriculum. British values plays a huge part in maintaining equality throughout. It looks into democracy, the rule of law, individual liberty, mutual respect, and tolerance of those with different faiths and beliefs. This is so important to include in the curriculum so students are able to understand and imitate correct behaviours. This policy is taking steps to improve the process that supports identification and assessment of potential exclusion. This could impact assessment design and delivery to make sure that all methods are inclusive and no one is being excluded throughout. If students become excluded, this allows them to become vulnerable to situations which could later cause students to become radicalised. As students, it's important that all assessment methods are inclusive to prevent this from happening. The final policy I want to discuss is about supporting Ukrainian children to integrate into English schools. As this is currently happening, there isn't much publication on this. However, on the 4th of May 2022, the government published a letter setting out the expectations that schools and local authorities should support Ukrainian children arriving in the UK and help them integrate into schools and local communities. This is going to have a massive impact on curriculum design and delivery. Inside this letter, it states, while schools should continue to prioritise delivering their usual curriculum, they may also wish to share these Ukrainian educational materials with incoming Ukrainian pupils and families. This meaning that teachers should now be including two different types of curriculum design and delivery to make sure that they are creating an inclusive and open environment for all. This will then possibly cause an impact on the assessment design and delivery of the course, as there will be different curriculum designs to think about when talking about assessments. This could cause a negative impact in both curriculum and assessment design and delivery. Teachers will feel pressured and overloaded with work that needs to be included inside. Because of this workload has gone up, this could cause the overall quality of the work to reduce. This is currently a really relevant topic to discuss and talk about and look into how it's going to affect and change curriculum and assessment design and delivery. Any type of policy that is put in place is more or less likely to cause an impact on curriculum and assessment design and delivery, which could either have a positive or negative effect on teachers and students' learning. This is why it's so important to constantly be considering this, as you as a teacher always need to find a way to overcome the negatives and create a positive learning environment. Now I'm going to discuss the annotations that I've made on the BTEC Level 3 specification. I will be talking about the different principles of curriculum design and linking these to different theories. As this course curriculum has a learner-centred approach, for the students to be successful, they must take on responsibility for their own growth and development, which will allow them to be prepared for the world outside of education. Tuckman's learning theory focuses on group development and gives students more responsibility and lets them work more independently. Throughout this specification, there's loads of opportunities for the students to take responsibility for their own work. This is a great way for students to gain independence. However, some students at this age may not be that independent. These courses also offer holistic development in interpersonal and thinking skills. Holistic development allows students to develop as a whole and not just in one area, so these being socially, emotionally, physically, intellectually, and spiritually. This is great for students as it allows them to strengthen each area of themselves and it's inclusive for everyone involved. Pearson courses will also furnish you with transferable skills, which will allow you to take these outside of education and into employment. The Department for Education and Employment define transferable skills as the centre of all occupation in all sectors and all different levels. Partaking in these courses will allow you to develop your transferable skills, whether these be in leadership, communication, working in teams, or problem solving. This course also offers student progression. This will allow students to understand what they need to do to get into the next step. This is offering a linear framework, stating that you need to finish this course to then move on to higher education. A linear learning process goes from one step to the next, highlighting that for the students to progress, they need to complete and gain knowledge at the certain standard before they can move on. The linear model could be linked to the behaviourism approach. It allows students to understand that the reward at the end of the qualification is that they'll be able to move on to the next step. Thorndike's behaviourism learning theory focuses on the process of trial and error and also relating this to the idea of rewarding success. This would be great for students as it will allow the students to have a goal in mind to finish this qualification to help them with motivation throughout. Each of the different modules seem to be following a thematic and spiral curriculum model. The thematic aspect of the curriculum is because each of the units has a specific area of interest, whether this be dance, acting or performing arts. And then inside this subject specialised area, there are loads of different units and topics relating to this. The spiral aspect is that all students are required to undertake different modules, constantly reflecting and developing on different skills. Both of these models will allow students to develop deeper thinking skills and become more sophisticated learners, which is great for the world outside of the educational setting. This specification also offers cross-curriculum with theoretical and practical skills and linking these throughout the duration of the course. Cross-curriculum offers a creative way to develop children's knowledge, skills and understanding while motivating them to learn through stimulating and interconnected topics. This is great for students as it allows them to get the required skills in a creative and motivating way. When students' motivation levels rise, this is when they start to develop and achieve the goals in mind. This specification pushes students to be an active group member. This would be considered as part of the hidden curriculum. It allows students to constantly work with different people, which will then help them to open their social expectations of different genders, languages, behaviours, and morals and beliefs. Hidden curriculum is so important in the educational setting as it unintentionally shows you how to act throughout life. This could be highlighted through Bandura's learning theory as it focuses on the importance of observation and setting examples, as the students normally imitate behaviours. So if you as the teacher become a good role model and create an open and inclusive environment, they will probably imitate this and take it on to their future practices. This specification also uses the Praxit model. It allows students to form knowledge at its most intense level, so they are able to go on to the next stage of education. The Praxit model is a cycle of theory and purposeful actions that incorporate reflection. This course offers both theory and practical inside the modules, which then they'll have to reflect upon later. This is great for students as it allows them to develop their thinking, doing and evaluation skills, which they can then take later on in the future. Overall, inside this specification, there is lots of different curriculum designs to help meet the needs of all the individual learners. These allow the qualifications to open an inclusive environment, which is great for students' motivation levels. These courses also furnish students with lots of different skills, such as wider skills, transferable skills, and also providing them with professionalism that they can take later on in the world outside of the educational setting. For the final section of the vlog, I will be reviewing and evaluating my assessment tool that I implemented into the classes, looking at the students' feedback, considering the overall effectiveness from the point of view of its fairness, validity, reliability, and sufficiency. I will also be considering an area of improvement that I would like to develop on if I were to use this tool again in the future. My assessment tool aim for the students was to develop a deeper understanding of ballet terminology and ballet knowledge. This task helped the learners to develop their individual skills and ability in a creative way. The questions had different difficulty levels, so these being from easy to harder, and each student at the end of the process received a feedback form, including areas that were meeting the criteria and areas that can be improved throughout the assessment tool to help each student's development. From the point of view of the assessment tool's fairness, I felt that every student had a great opportunity to progress inside this. There was many different styles of questions that suited all individual learners' styles and needs. This allowed each student to have an equal chance. So there was questions that were demonstrating, reading and writing, listening, and then finally there was some talking and describing questions. Offering different question styles to the learners is important as it allows the teacher to open an inclusive environment. This is beneficial as each student was able to see what areas they possibly needed to work on, and it was also useful for me as the teacher as it allowed me to understand further the different types of learners in the class so I could think about what would be beneficial in my future practice. I felt the validity of the assessment tool was at a really high standard. This is because all the questions that were inside were really, really relevant to the classical ballet technique. I felt that it was also good as it looked into the history of classical ballet, whilst also asking questions about the ballet pieces and performance that are currently coming out in the present day. So there was questions on the history and also questions that were about performances that are coming out today. This helped the students research into and possibly see how the classical ballet technique has developed and evolved over the past years. This was a great way for the students to take on some responsibility for their own professional development as they had to go away and research this themselves. However, it did become apparent quickly when students weren't doing their own researching and relying on other students' answers. As a teacher, I felt I should have possibly guided them more throughout the research and offered more support to those who are possibly struggling with this more. However, overall, I feel this assessment tool was really relevant to the topic of the classical ballet industry, which pushed and promoted the students to understand this further. The reliability of this assessment tool, I think, could be my area of improvement. I felt because sometimes I was asking the questions to the whole class and asking them to shout out the answers, some of the less advantaged students were unable to process and understand the questions before the other students who did know the answers had shouted them out. This caused some of the students to copy the other answers, which made it sometimes unclear to me as the teacher what their range of knowledge actually was and what areas of improvement to give them. I felt that if I were to use this assessment tool again, I would put a longer time frame for the students to be able to actually think about the questions before I ask them to shout out the answers. I feel this will open up a more positive learning environment for all, and it will create an inclusive space. This will then allow the students to feel more comfortable inside the classroom, which will then allow them to ask questions when they feel they need to. In terms of the assessment tool's sufficiency, I felt, again, this was at a really high standard. The assessment tool was a short and quick interactive task that helped students to push their knowledge. Because the task was short and interactive, I felt I was able to keep motivation and engagement levels high throughout. So when students start to feel engaged in tasks, this is when they start to develop and attain knowledge, which is what you want to see throughout an assessment. In terms of my written feedback, I felt this again was really sufficient as it gave really clear learning objectives for the students to assess their knowledge against. Also, inside each of the written feedbacks, I always made sure that I was giving areas of improvement throughout. This is so the students could be constantly pushing them and developing their skills further, even if they were at a really high standard and level. Finally, when looking at the feedback forms that I got from the students, all of the students stated that they thought it was really fun and motivating assessment tool. It was also stated that they loved the range of questions that was included and how this pushed and challenged them to develop in the technique and also in their classical ballet knowledge. This is great when students feel motivated, engaged in the task. This is when they start to develop their knowledge and progress in learning. Also, when looking through the areas of improvement, a lot of them were stating that they found the history questions hard. This could be another area of improvement for myself to help them with the research process so they're able to understand how to research sufficiently. Overall, I think this assessment tool worked really well with all of the students. It pushed an inclusive environment with different styles of questions. It was fun and engaging and also gave clear areas of development. I think in the future, I will definitely use this assessment tool again. I could also use this assessment tool in loads of different styles of dance. So it doesn't necessarily have to be the classical ballet technique. So I can make loads of little jars of all the different questions that I could use later in my practice.